and welcome to China Forum, the leading program for discussing the latest in trends and development in modern Chinese culture, politics, economics, and social issues. My name is Shannon Tiezi, and I will be your moderator for our program today. Today on China Forum, we'll be talking about Hong Kong, its relationship to China, and its role in the world. We're very pleased to be joined today by a special guest, Mr. Donald Tong. Mr. Tong is the Hong Kong Commissioner for Economic and Trade Affairs in the United States, the most senior representative of the Hong Kong Special Administrative Region Government in North America. He has served in this post since October 2008. Mr. Tong previously served as director of the Hong Kong Economic and Trade Office in Toronto, Canada. He has also held many government positions in Hong Kong, including serving as Deputy Secretary for Home Affairs. Mr. Tong helped organize the 2008 Olympic and Paralympic equestrian events held in Hong Kong and also oversaw the construction of Hong Kong International Airport. Mr. Tong, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for inviting me.
I'd like to start by just getting a basic overview of Hong Kong's government system. Since Hong Kong was handed over from British control to Chinese control, it has operated as a special administrative region of the People's Republic of China. This means that Hong Kong is governed according to the so-called principle of one country, two systems, which can be a bit confusing for Americans to understand. Could you just explain to us a little bit about how Hong Kong's government is organized?
Yes. Of course, after 1997, Hong Kong has reverted to the mainland of China. So Hong Kong is under one country, China. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, we've been assured and we have indeed been continuing our capitalist system and the way of life. And so the Hong Kong social economic systems are different from the mainland of China. And that's the reason the two systems.
Mm. And I know that Hong Kong is governed according to its basic law. Can you tell us a little bit about that and how it organizes Hong Kong's political system?
Sure. The basic law is a piece of constitutional document. Sometimes we call it a mini constitution for Hong Kong. It's part of the Hong Kong legal systems. It guarantees the implementation of the one country, two systems principle in Hong Kong. It also provides for the continuation of the capitalist system and way of life in Hong Kong. It also gives us a means that Hong Kong can continue, Hong Kong people will be running Hong Kong and we will be able to enjoy a high degree of autonomy. Under the basic law, Hong Kong also enjoys our own executive, administrative, and also independent judicial system. And of course, our legislative authority as well.
Mm-hmm. In addition to having a separate political system, Hong Kong also has a separate economic system, including its own currency.
Yes, indeed.
So could you explain for us a little bit about how the economy of Hong Kong and the economy of the PRC work together and interact?
Yeah. Indeed, Hong Kong has been taking, deriving lots of benefits from as a reversion into the mainland of China. The Hong Kong, for example, Hong Kong's trade, bilateral trade with the mainland has tripled since 1997. And of course, mainland China is now one of the most important economic powers in the world. So Hong Kong benefits significantly from that. In addition, in the past over a decade or so, we have also entered into some new trade agreements with the mainland China that also benefits Hong Kong. For example, under the Closer Economic Partnership Arrangement, we call it CEPA, C-E-P-A, which is a free trade agreement between Hong Kong and the mainland China. Products of Hong Kong origin can go into the mainland tariff-free. And also companies, service companies in Hong Kong can also enjoy preferential treatment in the mainland of China. Now, obviously, Hong Kong companies can benefit from that, from this free trade agreement. But overseas companies, for example, U.S. companies, when they are incorporated in Hong Kong, they would also be able to enjoy these benefits. And I tend to believe that this is one of the reasons why Hong Kong has remained one of the most attractive places on earth for overseas investments.
So Hong Kong has historically been seen as a gateway to China.
Yes.
And now as China's economy is starting to open up, it seems like Hong Kong has had to change its role to in order to maintain its attractiveness. And that obviously what you just talked about with SIPA is one way it does that.
Yes.
What are the other ways that Hong Kong maintains its competitiveness?
Yeah. Hong Kong has only one asset, people. So it is important for us to continue to invest heavily in education. Indeed, education amounts to roughly 22% of Hong Kong government's budget. It is the single biggest, largest expenditure, government expenditure in Hong Kong. By training up our people, Hong Kong would be able to help the mainland and also overseas companies. And obviously, we also need to step up our infrastructure. For example, particularly the cross-border infrastructure. Why? Because Hong Kong has 7 million people. But across the border between the mainland and China, each day we have roughly around half a million people crossing the land border alone, not taking into account the ferries and also the aeroplanes. So it is important for us to continue to step up the cross-border infrastructure, high-speed railway, and also highways and whatnot, so that we could continue to benefit from the developing and growing economic links that we have with the mainland of China. We have also been investing a lot in our airport, which is now the busiest air cargo hub in the world, and also in our container ports, which are now the third busiest in the world. So in the years ahead, we'll continue to do that. Obviously, there are also some many other new areas that we are working on. For example, developing Hong Kong as an international arbitration center, a wine auction center, and also an art auction center. And I'm glad to say that we have made some very good progress in these areas.
So, as of right now, what would you say are the biggest industries, the biggest part of Hong Kong's economy?
Yeah. In Hong Kong, services economies are the most important. Indeed, services now account for over 92% of Hong Kong's GDP. And out of the services sector, there are four particular areas which are most important. Logistics and trading. And logistics obviously include all these airport, container port operations. And then the second one is the financial services. Hong Kong is one of the major international financial center in the world. The third area is tourism. Last year, Hong Kong has around 48 million tourists from around the world. So Hong Kong is a good shopping center for our friends, particularly since there is no sales tax in Hong Kong, and no value-added tax as well. And then the fourth area is the professional services. For example, like accounting, legal services, arbitration services, exhibition and whatnot. And all of them have been doing very well. All these four services areas altogether account for around 58% of Hong Kong's GDP.
You mentioned service areas are obviously a big part of Hong Kong's economy.
Indeed.
Has this historically been the case, or are we seeing a shift in the past couple of decades?
Yeah, indeed, a very good question. Heavy industry never had a good chance in Hong Kong. But in Hong Kong, we used to excel in light industries. So at one stage, Hong Kong was the one of the most important toy manufacturing center, watches, and wigs, plastic products, and whatnot. But following the opening up of China in the next 70s, Hong Kong obviously has lost its advantages in terms of labor, the cost of labor, and also in terms of, for example, land and property prices. So lots of Hong Kong's factories have since then moved into the mainland of China. In order to survive, Hong Kong has no choice. Hong Kong has to develop into some other areas. And so that's the reason why we move into the services sectors. Yes, we have lost most of this manufacturing processes, plants and whatnot, to the mainland of China, and indeed to some other parts of Asia as well. But what Hong Kong has done is we continue to retain the sort of what we call the headquarters function. So the design, the financial services, marketing services, banking services, many of this remain in Hong Kong. And that's how Hong Kong survived. Okay. Of course, in order to cope with this change, we have to invest a lot in education. That's the issue that I discussed earlier on.
Right. So obviously Hong Kong benefits from its close relationship, but independent relationship with China. What organizations are really involved with helping coordinate like banking services, imports, exports? What organizations, both in Hong Kong and China, keep this running smoothly?
Yes. Actually, there is it spreads out amongst a lot of ministries and departments in Hong Kong. Obviously, at the very top level, the chief executive of the Hong Kong government, which is equivalent to President Obama in the U.S., has been in touch on a very frequent basis with the leadership in the mainland of China, discussing various sorts of opportunities under the sun, ranging from ports, airports, logistical services, and financial services. But at the same time, under the chief executive, there are also a number of ministries and departments in Hong Kong. So it could be trade and industry department, it could be intellectual property, it could be the Department of Justice, it could be customs department, industry department, and whatnot. So they would work. They have been working closely with their counterparts in the mainland of China to on various fronts to safeguard and to promote the interests of Hong Kong. But I would say one key area which I should put emphasis on is the Hong Kong's role in the mainland's 12 five-year plan. Because Hong Kong, under the 12 five-year plan, Hong Kong would be developed as and continue to develop as an international financial logistics and also shipping center for the mainland of China and indeed for the world. And so this is the big goal which the both governments are working on. And of course, Hong Kong will also continue to serve as an offshore renminbi center for mainland of China.
So when the PRC puts Hong Kong in its 12 five-year plan and sets goals for Hong Kong, do they help provide funding for any of those goals, or are the financial systems completely separate in that sense?
The financial systems are completely separate. Okay. As you rightly point out, we print our own currency, and Hong Kong has a different system from the mainland of China. But by collaboration, Hong Kong has created lots of new opportunities for Hong Kong. One example is the development of Hong Kong as an offshore renminbi business center. Renminbi, or sometimes called yuan, is the Chinese currency. So what by China, because it's now internationalizing its currency, so Hong Kong has been able to benefit significantly from developing itself as an international offshore renminbi center for the mainland of China. And China has been issuing the its sovereignty renminbi bonds in Hong Kong, and Hong Kong has been taking care of the renminbi trade settlement business for the mainland of China. So Hong Kong, that creates new business opportunities for Hong Kong, although China does not have to inject new money into Hong Kong at all.
We've talked a lot about how China and Hong Kong interact. I'd like to turn the focus a little bit now to talk about Hong Kong and the rest of the international community. Obviously, Hong Kong has international representation around the world.
Yes.
You are, in fact, the leader of one of those offices, the Hong Kong Economic and Trade Office here in the U.S. So could you just give us an overview of what your office does, what its role is?
Yeah. Our most important job is to foster closer economic, trade, and cultural ties between the U.S. and Hong Kong. We actually have three offices in the U.S. Obviously, the headquarters is in Washington, D.C., but we also have offices in San Francisco and also in New York. And I'm glad to say that we have made very good progress in fostering closer relationship between the two economies. Yeah. And one other area is we specialize in helping U.S. companies to invest in Hong Kong. And I'm glad to say that right now we have around 1,400 U.S. companies in Hong Kong, and most of them are doing extremely well.
Oh, well, that's good news for the U.S. economy.
Yes, indeed.
Does Hong Kong have offices like this in other countries around the world?
Altogether, we have 15 economic and trade offices across the globe, and also one office in Beijing. Many of these offices are indeed in our most important trading partners. So in addition to US, we also have one in Canada, a few in Europe, and then a few in Australia and ASEAN, like Singapore and Japan. We do not have offices all around the world, but only at our only in places which are our most important trading partners.
What about in truly international organizations, like the World Trade Organization, the International Monetary Fund? Is Hong Kong specifically represented in those organizations?
It depends really on whether the membership is confined to sovereign power or whether it's open up to non-sovereign power. So for example, in the World Trade Organization and also APEC, the World Customs Organization, Hong Kong is has our own separate membership from that of the mainland of China. So yes, mainland China is a separate member, but we are also Hong Kong also maintains its own separate membership. But in some other organizations, like World Bank, International Monetary Fund, and for definitely United Nations, simply by virtue that Hong Kong is not a sovereign power, so we cannot be a member. And certainly we are not a member of the G20, but through the mainland, through the Chinese membership, sometimes on a need basis, Hong Kong will attend as a member of the Chinese delegation.
Yeah. Okay. And you mentioned earlier that Hong Kong has special offices mostly in the countries that are its major trading partners.
Yes.
Could you list some of Hong Kong's major trading partners for
us? It would be the most important office is the mainland of China. So we have offices in quite a number of cities like Shanghai, also in Beijing, and also in Chengdu. We also have offices in Europe, which is also another major important trading partner. So we have offices in Berlin, in Brussels, and also in London. We have also an office in Geneva, which deals with Hong Kong's membership as a World Trade Organization member. We also have offices in ASEAN, so Austria, although it's not ASEAN, but it's also a very important trading partner, and also in Singapore and Tokyo. Canada is another important major partner, but it is the US, which is very special. The US is the only foreign country whereby we have more than one office.
Okay.
This I think signifies the importance of Hong Kong's trading relationship with the US. Many of our American friends may not know, but Hong Kong is now the 10th largest export destination for the US. And Hong Kong is the single largest source of US trade surplus with any trading partners. And one other thing, if you like wine, Hong Kong is also the third largest wine destination for the US. Hong Kong people have been drinking a lot of US wine.
So obviously wine is a major area of opportunity between the Hong Kong and US. Are there any other specific industries that you think provide special opportunities for US or other countries' businesses?
Yeah, certainly. I think because Hong Kong is an important international logistic center and also financial center, that means that Hong Kong has to import a lot of high-speed computer and electronic products from around the world. US is a leader in this area. So I would say computer and electronic products, high-tech products, they will continue to have a very good prospect in Hong Kong. The another area would be, healthcare products and also the ferrous metal and non-ferrous metal. They also have a very good prospect in Hong Kong. Another major area which is coming up in addition to wine would be, the artwork, because Hong Kong is developing our West Kowloon Cultural District. This is a 100-acre district with around 17 performing venues and a big museum. So I would tend to believe that this would create lots of opportunities for those in the art field in the U.S., be it facilities management, artwork, performing groups, art education. We very much look forward to having American presence and assistance in this regard.
So Hong Kong places a big emphasis on the arts. And traditionally, actually, it's been seen as an economic gateway, but also a cultural gateway to China. In fact, a lot of the movies that American audiences think of as classic Chinese films were made by Hong Kong directors. Does Hong Kong still maintain this sort of cultural gateway role now that China is actively trying to export its own films to the rest of the world?
Yeah, I think Hong Kong remains a key player in this area. Indeed, quite a number of Hollywood movies are produced and will continue to be produced in Hong Kong. Hong Kong is also a, we have also export. Indeed, in a way, we have lost some good Hong Kong artists like Chow Yun-fat, like Jet Li, to Hollywood. We have also some good directors, Johnny To, certainly John Woo, who have been doing extremely well in Hong Kong and now in the US. I'm pretty sure that there are lots of room for collaboration in Hong Kong, and we certainly welcome more American movies to be produced in Hong Kong. One particular point which I would like to stress is the presence of a campus by the Savannah College of Art and Design, or SCAD, based in Savannah. It has opened a campus in Hong Kong, doing extremely well. It certainly has provided opportunities for American and international students to participate or to study in Hong Kong, and maybe after graduation to participate in the Hong Kong, to develop their careers in Hong Kong. But at the same time, I think it has also provided lots of good training, education for some of the local talents. And we tend to believe that this would certainly help to boost Hong Kong's cultural industry now and in the years to come.
I know the mainland China is trying very hard to build up its film and cultural industries.
Yes.
Are they turning to Hong Kong for help, since Hong Kong has a long history of creating movie stars, famous directors?
In these days, actually, there have been lots of collaboration. The Hong Kong market, to be honest, is small. We only have around 7 million people. Mainland, 1.3 billion people. So that has lots of sharing co-production, we call it in these days. By co-producing the movies and indeed having sometimes the, it's not just the actors, actresses, but also the script writing, production and whatnot. This co-production movie would have the advantages of both worlds. They could have access to the box office, certainly in Hong Kong, but perhaps more importantly in the mainland of China. And there are lots of successful examples. Indeed, many of the best sellers movies in the mainland of China are mostly co-productions with Hong Kong. Mm-hmm. So I think the formula works extremely well. And that is also a way whereby Hong Kong, one of the way we export our professional services, or sharing our professional talents with other parts of the world. This is not just to the benefit of Hong Kong, but also to the benefit of the mainland as well.
Hong Kong and mainland China are facing a lot of similar issues. Obviously, infrastructure problems with the growing population, housing costs are rising, what you do with people who may not be permanent residents of an area, but they live and work there. Is there any sort of collaboration on common solutions for these problems between the central Chinese government and Hong Kong, or are each of them experimenting in different ways?
Yeah. We do share experience with Beijing and also with provincial governments. And of course, for those, particularly for those in southern China, simply because of the huge number of Hong Kong investors in say, for example, the Guangdong province, Zhuhai and whatnot, we have even worked closer with them. And it does not just confine to the area of economic development. There are also many other areas whereby we work together. For example, on infrastructure support, cross-border infrastructure support, high-speed railway, highways, how to smoothen the immigration and border control. There is still a border between the mainland of China and Hong Kong. So without a particular permit, you will not be, it's not a passport because it's one country. Mm-hmm. But without a special permit, mainlanders could not come to Hong Kong. And Hong Kong people cannot go to the mainland. So we see the border, we have border we have immigration and customs control on either side. So we have to make arrangements to facilitate such control. We also have to deal with, for example, environmental problems. Mm-hmm. One of the prices, one of the prices that we have to pay for economic development. But the important thing is that the Hong Kong government and also our we have been working closely with the governments in the Pearl River Delta to deal with such issues. So there are lots of exchange. And of course, for example, sometimes it could be as simple as polluting rivers. Mm. It's just right at the border. We both of us would have to seriously deal with them to control the pollution at source to mitigate the problem. Otherwise, there is no point of addressing the problem at one end, mm-hmm. and then the other side is not working on it. So there are lots of areas whereby we need to collaborate. And I'm glad to say that these are achieving very good results. And indeed on the area of pollution, for example, I mentioned earlier on that quite a number of manufacturing facilities in the mainland of China are indeed Hong Kong investments. Mm. So the Hong Kong government, in order to combat pollution, we actually offer technical assistance and also give subsidy to Hong Kong investors so as to upgrade their pollution control technology in their plants in the mainland of China. Obviously, this will benefit our friends in the mainland of China, but at the same time, Hong Kong also benefit as well. So this is how we collaborate.
Great. Well, unfortunately, that's all the time we have for today, but I know I learned a lot about Hong Kong, and I'm sure our viewers did too, so thank you for joining us.
Thanks again, Shen.
And we will see you next week on China Forum. Thank you for joining us.